Sometimes there is the right person in the right place to embody the time and place. In the 1920s, the place was Paris, and the person was Kiki de Montparnasse. Born as Alice Prin, she adopted the name Kiki for her life as the most famous artist's model of her time. Picasso, Hemingway, Man Ray, and virtually every important artist of the lost generation fell under her spell. The new graphic biography, Kiki de Montparnasse, by Catel and Bocquet, allows us to take another look at the icon.
Il est une coutume en Angleterre, c'est le charmant jour des primavères.
As everyone in the world, we knew this picture. But there is a question, who is this woman? Kiki is a country girl. We become the most famous model in the 20th century in the history of art. When she was a teenager, she left Châtillon-sur-Seine to go to Paris. She was 16, alone in the streets in Paris. And to survive, she became a model.
Montparnasse was the quarter, the most bohemian avant-garde quarter of anywhere, where all the artists and all the writers gathered. So Kiki was one of the first liberated people in the avant-garde, and she was in fact so liberated that very young she went to pose nude when she was 14 and therefore got thrown out by her mother and therefore had to earn a living exactly like that. And everybody adored her. She posed for so many portraits, you know, of Kisling and everything is Soutine, and of course Man Ray, with whom she was involved for like 20 years. So Man Ray and Kiki were a number for a long, long time. First she went to pose for him, and then he said, I'm not a painter, I'm a photographer. She said, no way. And he said, but I paint with my photographs. That's exactly what I do. I'm an artist with photography. And so, of course, she found he was, and then they were together for a very, very long time. And I think that was the real love of her life.
We wanted to get in the life of everybody around Kiki. Picasso, Modigliani, Man Ray, Tristan Tzara.
Everyone did portraits of Kiki. The creativity around Kiki was extraordinary. An amazing thing happened at one point. Robert Desnos, who was of course a friend of both of theirs, wrote a poem called The Starfish, L'Etoile de Mer, and Man Ray made a film about it. You see Kiki sitting on a bed and doing a very slow striptease. And what happened, because things were being censured all the time, was that Man Ray smeared gelatin on the lens. And so what you see is this kind of fuzzy striptease, and it could in no way be censored because it isn't clear enough to have to be cut down.
Kiki, c'est une femme libérée. Dans les années 20, elle est un modèle de vie. Anti-bourgeois, évidemment.
Anti-conventionnel. C'est pour ça que je parlais du fait qu'elle soit actrice, pas seulement comme métier, bon, elle était modèle et actrice aussi. D'ailleurs, elle est venue faire du cinéma à New York. Mais elle était surtout actrice de sa vie. C'est-à-dire qu'elle n'avait aucune contrainte et qu'elle vivait comme elle le ressentait. Et elle l'a payé très cher.
So, in a sense, the fact that she already weighed about 175 pounds at the end of her life seems to me to all go together with the way she had had to fight so hard for being a liberated woman. She was everywhere and she was doing everything. I don't understand how somehow she got erased from a certain memory.
Elle a été quand même la reine de Montparnasse en 1930, élue reine de Montparnasse. Elle a été le modèle de la photo la plus vendue au monde. Donc c'est très étonnant qu'on ait totalement oublié ce personnage. Et je pense que nous pensons que son émancipation fait partie du prix qu'elle a payé en disparaissant.
It may be difficult to imagine an Afghanistan without war, but it exists today. The Wakhan Corridor in the far northeast of the country is so isolated that it remains untouched by the strife elsewhere. In 2011, two 33-year-old French heard of this remarkable fact from an article in the New York Times and decided to make a photographic chronicle of the region, something never done before. Canape takes a look at the striking images that they found of people living outside the modern world.
Basically, we are childhood friends. We grew up together from the age of 5 till the age of 10 in Paris. 25 years later, we got reconnected through common friends and social networks. So we decided to meet. We realized that we had many things in common to share, the wish to give a new start to our lives. And that's how this whole project started. The only way to reach the Wakhan Corridor is basically to go through Tajikistan, which is the country neighboring Afghanistan on the north side. It's impossible to go there through Kabul because you would have to cross all the war zones.
You enter East Kashim, it's the beginning of the Wakhan Corridor. We took a car during 2 days to reach the latest Wahi village, and then we start trekking from that village during 25 days. We had around 40 kilos of equipment, and we carried this on the back of a donkey, loaded with solar panels so we could recharge all the batteries, hard drives, equipment and computers.
The whole idea at the beginning was to document those cultures that are basically totally unknown cultures. It's so remote that this area hasn't been covered by any photographers or journalists. And the idea was to shoot the people and give them the picture as a gift to begin an interaction and to begin a dialogue and a communication with them.
For most of the people, it was the first time that they would be taken in picture. And it was for sure the first time people would offer them a portrait of themselves. So the first portrait you take of your encounter, you realize that it's really important for them, this notion of being taken in picture. So the first pose would be really serious, really, you could feel the dignity of the pose in the first image. And then asking to stage a Polaroid, we would enter a second level of communication and second level of interaction with them, where we could have really more fun. So you have a double lecture of the same person through this concept. It takes time to get into people's heart and people's attention. It's really easier with kids, as usual. And at one point, we would meet those three kids in Kret village, where we started to learn them Bob Marley's song.
Peace, man. Get up, stand up. Get up, fire your eyes. Peace, man.
And it was, it was a funny, funny moment to spend with them interacting with this song, which is obviously a peaceful song. So
it was the choice of Bob Marley wasn't totally coming out of the blue. I mean, this part of Afghanistan is an extremely peaceful area. There is no Taliban, no American soldiers. People live, in a state of kind of blessing, although the living conditions are very rough. But in a way, having these kids singing Bob Marley with us were the kind of, you know, funny twist that we found to just change a little bit the perspective that one can have on this area of the world.
We're here in New York for a show in May, 18th of May at Mill Gallery, where we're going to present a different series of work. We're going to present, of course, this Polaroid series that we call Traces of Time. And we're going to present several video short movies that we shot. And in these images, some of the images have been shot by the kids themselves or teenagers themselves. For us, the idea is to show another Afghanistan.
Usually, image is used as a weapon against Afghanistan because all that you see when you turn on the TV are images of war, IEDs, Talibans, and terrible things. But now we're using images created by the people themselves, staged by them, to create another way of seeing things, more positive storytelling. And if we succeed in changing a little bit the perspective of what most people think about this country, then it would be for us the greatest tribute we could pay to those amazing encounters we had for the 2 months we spent in Afghanistan.
The deep effects of divorce upon children may go even deeper if the change includes two countries. Mathieu Demy's first feature film, Americano, which he wrote and in which he plays the central character, explores a son's search for an understanding of his recently deceased, long-estranged mother as he comes to Los Angeles to repatriate her body to France. The young filmmaker talks to Canape about a film that mixes times and places to portray the intimacy of family.
I wanted to make a story that was both a little bit personal and a little bit a metaphor of something else. So I wanted to talk about things that were you know, personal to my life, and it was important to to make a movie that people would enjoy if possible. So I decided pretty early to make a road movie about grief, and this was very early in the project. I wanted this character to lose himself in order to find himself and solve his problems. So in the very beginning I said, okay, I want to do this road movie, a little bit of an adventurous type of film about a very intimate subject.
So, you wanted to see me? That's nice. You like what you saw? Mm-hmm. Oh, you don't talk? Here, let me help you.
You're Lola.
Me? It's Lola. It's your first time in Mexico?
I don't know.
So you're here for business or pleasure? Oh, it's really hot in here. Can I get a drink? Luis? Listen, I want you to come with me. Let's go somewhere quiet.
Because you're a friend of my mother, Emily. You know her, right?
Look, in here, please don't talk about your mother, okay? It's just you and me, baby. What's your little name again?
Martin.
Martin. Martin.
We used to know each other when we were kids in Los Angeles.
I have a very bad memory.
We played together sometimes in the courtyard. I had a skateboard and
Martin, do you have money?
No, not really.
Well, that's not gonna help me remember anything.
Wait. Here.
I've started, you know, acting in French films like 20 years ago, and I've been doing that a lot, and I really enjoy it. And maybe this is the reason why, when I started to write some stories, I pictured myself in, you know, in that story. And I guess I find this is the most interesting way to do films for me at the moment, is to try to tell some really intimate stuff in a fiction, in something that is not a documentary at all, and that is, you know, obviously a fiction and obviously a tale, or, you know. So yeah, in the film there are many bridges between reality and fiction, but these bridges are, when you know the backstory, when you know a little bit more about my background, but you don't have to know that to enjoy the film. You know, I really wanted to make a film that everybody could see. And if you want to find some other connections, you also can do that. So I grew up a little bit in Los Angeles, and this is where my mother, so Agnès Varda, did this film with me inside being a kid called Documentaire that I used for the flashbacks. So a part of my childhood is here in the United States. And even, you know, as a viewer or as a filmmaker, my influences are very various, and there's, I love American cinema, I love independent American cinema, mainstream American cinema, the French New Wave, there's many Italian cinema, there's so many things that I don't feel 100% French as a, in my visual influences. So as a first feature, you know, I also wanted to make a point about that, and I thought it was interesting to travel and to forge your identity through, you know, through this journey. So yeah, he finds his identity, but not even in the States. He has to cross another border. He finds it in Mexico. So yeah, it's really a film about traveling and finding more who you are. And the whole film is a little bit a metaphor for that character that I play, of me, you know, becoming a filmmaker and trying to also find my way through that.
A prolific publisher and exhibition organizer with a razor-sharp comprehension of the graphic arts, Delpire has had a defining hand in the careers of many of the master photographers of recent history. The cultural services of the French Embassy, in collaboration with Aperture Gallery, the gallery at Hermès, and La Maison Française of New York University, presented Delpire and Company, an exhibition featuring a half century of achievement in the life and career of visionary French publisher, editor, and curator Robert Delpire.
I guess I love the fact that you can't categorize him. I love how eclectic he is. He never says, I am a photography person, or I am a graphic design person. He's a person of culture. He's a person of words, and he's like a Renaissance man. You look at the show has everything. You know, you have advertising over there, you have magazines all over the place, you have social issues and Amnesty International and Médecins Sans Frontières, you have video and movies, and you have exhibitions, and you have extraordinary books, either by the best photographers ever, or on subjects that are important to our times.
Il a été un précurseur d'une certaine manière, puisqu'il a commencé dans les années 50 à montrer des photographies, alors que les gens s'intéressaient pas tellement à la photographie à ce moment-là. Neuf connaissait l'histoire, il était à la faculté de médecine, ils ont demandé une petite revue pour relater les événements de la faculté, et il a dit, moi je veux bien m'en occuper, il avait 20 ans ou 22 ans, mais à condition de faire une revue de luxe. Et on lui a dit, mais comment tu vas faire une revue de luxe? Et il a dit, ben, je vais demander au laboratoire de nous financer. C'était le début de la publicité. Et il est allé voir les gens qu'il admirait, que ce soit Sartre, Cartier-Bresson, Brassailles à l'époque. Et à la suite de ça, il a commencé à faire de l'édition et il a fait cette collection qui s'appelle l'Encyclopédie essentielle. C'est sur un sujet, que ce soit le soleil, l'arbre. Il réunissait des documents et il demandait un texte et il faisait un livre. Et puis, il a fait beaucoup autour de la photographie. Il était directeur du CNP pendant 14 ans, du Centre National de la Photographie, et c'est là où il a fait tous les photopoches. c'est une monographie de l'histoire de la photographie, faite pour les étudiants parce qu'ils trouvaient que c'était vraiment dommage que les gens ne puissent pas s'acheter des livres de photos. Je trouve que c'est une collection magnifique, j'adore, parce qu'elle est abordable et qu'en même temps, elle est vraiment bien faite. C'est un témoin et son choix témoigne de ses intérêts. De ses intérêts, de sa curiosité, de ses goûts. Mais c'est ça le travail d'un éditeur. Il dit toujours d'ailleurs qu'il n'existerait pas s'il n'avait pas rencontré les gens qu'il a rencontrés, que ce soit Steinberg dans l'illustration, ou Cartier-Bresson, ou Robert Frank dans la photographie. C'est évident que, je veux dire, c'est un maillon d'une chaîne, finalement, de faire un livre. Mais ça part d'un artiste. Ça part d'un artiste, ou d'un sujet, ou d'une idée, ou d'une collection. Finalement, il a su communiquer son goût à lui, sa vision à lui, son sens des choses, son éclectisme, la possibilité d'expression qu'il y avait dans différents registres, aussi bien que dans différents médiums, parce que l'illustration et la photographie, c'est pas pareil, la peinture, c'est pas pareil. Il a vraiment une œuvre. Ça me paraît une évidence parce que ça fait 40 ans que je le connais et que je vis avec lui, mais je trouve qu'il est formidable.
André Téchiné's latest film, Unforgivable, takes a disappearance among a set of French expats living in Venice as its starting point to render subtle psychology and astute social observation among characters of different classes and generations. Lead female performer Carole Bocquet sits down to chat with Canape about the film and its filmmaker.
Venice is really part of the movie, it's like a character in the movie. And everybody forgets, which is really very important, that Venice is an island. And it's not a detail, because on an island, the pace is different, the rhythm is different, like on any island. And because, you know, people are flying in and they build that train, you know, but I mean, that was built. Still, the people from Venice are the rhythm of an island. So when you're in Venice and you live in Venice, you belong to that rhythm, you know, you have to take that pace.
Pense à ta mère.
Mais sa fidélité s'est ruinée. Ça a même fini par l'achever.
Qu'est-ce que tu racontes? Elle a eu un accident de voiture.
T'as pas dit qu'elle était bourrée de calmant? Et toi, t'avances avec ton bouquin?
Oh, moi, quand je suis amoureux, j'arrive pas à écrire.
Ah. It is like a thriller, but about sentiment. It's very peculiar because it's not, you know, an action movie, but it's an action movie about human desire. And that's what it is about. And of course, fantasy. You never see the people, the person you live with, the man you're in love with, the woman you're in love with, where they are. Never. And it's always fantasies, of course. Sometimes in our lives, you know, you do cross and you get close. But it's very rare, those moments. And most of the time anyway, it's interpretation. That's what we do all the time, all of us.
Ma fille a disparu depuis 3 jours, je sais pas quoi faire. Je fais toujours le même rêve. On retire une enfant de la lagune, c'est Alice, elle est morte. Je vais te faire une proposition, c'est un travail facile. Il s'agit de suivre une femme. 500 euros par semaine. 500 euros?
Everybody thought, since I'm 18, I started to be, you know, an actress when I was 18 with the Buñuel movie, with that obscure object of desire. You do understand with such a title that people thought, you know, I belong to the title, which was completely insane. I was 18 and extremely shy. But then when I was walking into a room, when I was going to restaurants, and at that time I was in New York, you know, it was like that obscure object of desire was walking in, which was really completely schizophrenic for me because I was far from that. Sometimes you do play with an image. I was not playing with that. But it just, I mean, that's the first image, and it's been keep on going, by the way. And of course, you are an actress with your body and with your face. I mean, you can't go against it, it will be absurd. That's part of you, you have to play with it. And André Téchiné plays with it in the movie too, you know, but he plays it in a way I like, by the way.
Michael est très fort, ta fille. Elle a réussi à nous gâcher la vie.
Depuis cet été, rien n'est à sa place.
Plus cette fois-ci, plus j'apprends à te connaître, moi je sais qui tu es. Non, mais il fallait que je coupe avec toi, papa. Je voulais te faire du mal, ça c'est sûr.
The really beauty of that movie is that the man was not a teenager. I'm talking about André Téchiné, says that love is possible. And when somebody says that and is very young, you know, I'm not that impressed. But when somebody like Téchiné was a very conscious man and really looks in depth in characters, that's what he has been doing since the beginning of his movies, says, yes, love is possible. And with all the turmoil, with all the vicissitude, I don't know if you say that in English, I love that word in Italian and in French, vicissitudine, vicissitudes in French. I mean, the difficulties, the ups and downs, whatever, life. That it, yes, you can love each other. Yes, you can relate to somebody. Yes, sometimes you do meet somebody, you know, another human being that you can connect. I was really moved by that, extremely moved by it, because it's a very generous and intelligent at the same time, you know, way of saying, telling the story. That's what he does in the movie.